So today is October the 2nd, 2017. This is Xinyi Li.
And this is Tintin He.
We are interviewing Marianne G for Houston Asian American Archive. So, can you tell me when and where were you born?
I was born in Lake Village, Arkansas, mm-hmm. January 13th, 1936.
So can you describe your hometown in Arkansas? What is it like in the neighborhood and what type of people live there?
I left Arkansas when I was 5 years old.
Oh, okay.
So I really have no recollection of anything, but I have seen pictures. And we had a grocery store, and it's typical of the grocery stores that were in the Mississippi and Arkansas area, where they had a grocery store, and at the back of the store, the families lived there. And I don't remember anything about Arkansas because I left there so young. But I have read the book called Chop Six in the Land of the Delta or something, and have a better idea of how they live, but I don't remember it. I came from a family of 12, and so my older brothers and sisters would remember it, but we never talked about it. Okay. And they're gone.
Oh.
They're all gone.
So, sorry, which sibling were you?
I'm number 7.
Oh.
There were 5 girls and 12 and 7 boys. And so I'm 7, so that's pretty far down.
Okay, so can you describe your parents? Like, what kind of work did they do, and where are they from?
They were from Hoi Ping, and they spoke Cantonese. My father was single when he was in Arkansas at first, and he went back to marry my mother. And I'm not sure what year it was. And there is some question about the store. Did he come there to work with another G? Because it was called NG. And my father's name was YUM. So there's no one around that I can ask. Was there a G family that had the store first? And they notified my father, and he came there. I don't know. Those are all questions that have not been answered. But before my father went back to China, and I learned this from his immigration papers, he had to be certified as being a merchant. That was at the time of the Chinese Exclusion Act. Was it 1882? It was passed. And so people could not enter the United States unless they were merchants, or wives of merchants, I think. So before he went back, he knew that he had to be certified, but he had to be certified by white men. Could not have another Chinese say that he had a grocery store. And so he made sure that was done before he left. And he went back to the village, married my mother, and then he came back to that store. They both worked in the grocery store. My older brothers and sisters probably helped in the store. But I was very small, so I don't remember anything.
Do you remember when and why did your father immigrate from China to U.S.?
Now, this is something else. We didn't ask our father, right? But I think he came to California with his uncle. And he is a G. This is our correct name. And he worked out there as a dishwasher and did all kinds of jobs. He was only like 15. And if I had all those papers from immigration, I could tell you when he came to Arkansas. We don't know why he came unless someone from the village said this is a good place for you to come. It's real easy to get a store and have your own business and, you know, work in the store. But he did stop first in California, and how long he stayed there, we're not sure.
Okay. So did your parents speak English or just only Cantonese?
My father spoke some English, my mother very little. But we, since we were further down the line, we didn't speak much English, I mean much Chinese. My older brothers and sisters could speak Chinese, but we spoke English. Our playmates, I guess, must have been English, you know. And of course, our store was primarily, our customers were black. In Arkansas, the Chinese were kind of in between. They were not part of the white group, and they were not part of the black group. And the white grocers didn't really want to service blacks. Remember, they thought they were, you know, above them and had used blacks as their slaves. And so the Chinese were smart enough to come in and fill that niche. And so they didn't mind servicing the blacks. So most of the Chinese stores were in the black area.
Can you give some more examples of like how Chinese were in between whites and blacks?
This is back in Arkansas, which I know nothing about. And the only thing I know is from reading.
And reading the book?
Reading the book, uh-huh. And talking to Chinese who came later.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
See, I wasn't even in school when I was in Arkansas. So, at 4 years old, how much do you know? But through talking to ones later on and through reading, I realized that, realized things like the Chinese in Mississippi could not go to school with the whites.
Mm-hmm.
They had to go to school with the blacks. In Arkansas, they could go to school with the whites. We came to Houston in 1941, I believe. And the reason we came was because I originally thought it was because we had an uncle who was opening a Chinese restaurant here, and he sent out to people from the village that he needed workers. And I thought that was the reason my father came. Well, that may have been one of the reasons, but only in 2013, which was like almost 4 years ago, did we learn from a friend that he played with that we came because my older sister was going to be valedictorian of her senior class, and they said she couldn't be because she was Chinese. And in that book I read, this was not an unusual thing. A lot of the ones who were supposed to be valedictorians could not be.
Okay.
But it's strange that no one in our family ever told us this. And it wasn't until after my older brother passed away and Susan had a business transaction with this gentleman, and it was his father that had been my brother's best friend when he was 12 years old. So I told Susan, you might need to interview him, because he knew about what was going on. And he's not Chinese, he's Caucasian.
So your family didn't really talk about immigrating or their like past
not
lives
really
in China?
Not really. I don't know if my older brothers and sisters ever asked my father about this. You know, there were 12 people and children in the family, and we just were all working in the store and didn't ever talk about it, which may have been the case with a lot of Chinese families at that time.
Do you have any idea why?
Maybe they just wanted to assimilate. Maybe they didn't think it was that important. They were here, and how they got here wasn't that important, which is the case for a lot of immigrant groups. It's not until they're older, maybe when they're even senior citizens, that they start thinking about, well, how did we get here? And by then, my father and mother were gone when I started being interested in finding out what they did.
Okay. So you moved to Houston when you were five?
Mm-hmm.
What do you remember? How did you guys get there? Why did you choose Houston?
I remember we were on a train. First time I ever rode a train. And I remember always having to go to my mother to get food and snacks because she had this big basket with food, and that's all I remember. 5 years old, that was big then.
Yeah. Okay, so let's move to your family. So you said you have 11 siblings or 10?
Mm-hmm. 11 siblings. There were a dozen.
Okay. So what was it like growing up in a huge family?
We always had playmates. And there was always older ones to tell you what to do. But they were the ones who helped my parents in the business transactions because they could speak English. I'm trying to think. There were two girls, and then there were three boys, and then a sister just older than me. And then after that, there were three boys, then a sister and a brother. I was actually closer to my brothers below me, I guess, because I was a tomboy. And so I played games with them. And so I was not that close to my sister, who was just a year and a half older than me. I was a tomboy, so I played baseball, basketball, whatever, with them.
What would the girls do?
The girls, I can't even remember what they do, but we did always play house in the yard. I remember we would start off on one side where it was shady, and then when the sun moved, we'd move over. And that's boys and our family, boys and girls, played together. We made things like mud pies and acted like we were cooking. And we played, we didn't have that many toys. We played with a lot of cardboard boxes and cans and bottles that we had in the store. So we made do with what we had. We ate well because we had a grocery store. But as far as toys, we didn't have many. Now, we lived in the black areas when we came here. We had grocery stores, and we didn't live in the back of the store. We lived in a house that was attached to the store. So it was similar to what they had known in Arkansas. And my father, I know, extended credit to a lot of the customers. And, you know, they would bring in their check. And they might not pay for everything, pay the whole debt, but he would allow them to charge again.
So, do you need to take care of your siblings?
We did have to take care of them. I remember taking care of the two youngest. Two of them were born here in Houston, but and my older brothers and sister probably took care of us. But you know, parents were working in the store, but we were right there next door to the store, and so it wasn't like they were away, but we did have to take care of them. But we also worked in the store. I remember at age 6, I could check out groceries, just a few items, and I could make change at age 6. But that was true of many of the Chinese because they grew up knowing about money and you learned how to make change at a very early age. And we thought nothing of it. We also had to, if we had a sale, like we had 5 pounds of potatoes on sale, we had to learn how to weigh and package 5 pounds of potatoes. I don't know if we did rice. I can't remember all of that. But one thing I do remember, we had to package spices, you know, like chili peppers and bay leaves and all of that. And the job we hated was packaging black pepper. because we would sneeze. So after you package, you know, so many sneeze, you had to turn your head because you were sneezing. But all of us worked in the store. We would have to sweep up at night. We would have to stock the shelves. We would, you know, have to put soda in the refrigerators. So we all worked in the store. So that's why my first job was being a cashier in a grocery store.
So that's when you were 8?
I thought I was about 15, but, you know, I could have been as young as 13. Mm-hmm. Okay. It was probably illegal to hire me.
Did you get paid?
Yeah. Oh. When I went out, we didn't get paid in our family store. Mm-hmm. But I went out to work in the store, and I got paid. And I would give the money to my mother. Didn't think about keeping it. I was so young.
So you helped support the family?
Yeah. And so I remember definitely giving her the money. And for some reason, $35 a week stays with me, but that may have been when I was a little older. I don't remember what I made when I first went out to work. But summers from high school and even from college, I always worked in a Chinese grocery store during the summer. I didn't go out. I did go out one time to try to get an office job at one of the companies downtown, but they were not paying as much. And so I just went back to working in the grocery store.
So what were your family's economic circumstances? Do you remember how much they earn?
We were not middle class by any means, I don't think. We were probably a little below, but we didn't know it. And we always had more than enough to eat because of the grocery store. But we never went on vacations. I don't know if we ever went to movies when we were little. But my father was very generous, and he would help out Chinese families. And I have a cousin who worked for a meat company, and he said whenever I would come, you know, to take an order, when I got in my car, your father would have put in the car a bag of rice and canned goods and items that we would use. So even though we may not have had much, he still shared. And we had a big yard and a big garden. My mother, I assume, brought seeds from China. So we had dongguo, we had bitter melon, we had the long beans, we had ong choy. We had all of those, and people always came over to get it because we were one of the few families that had a big garden. But Mom and Dad would never accept money. We just gave it away. And I remember distinctly that most times they would bring something, and it was usually a big box of donuts. Why? Maybe it was Shipley donuts. I don't know what kind they were, but I remember that most times, you know, they felt they had to bring something because we wouldn't let them pay. And it was Shipley donuts or some kind of donut.
So would that be like the only source of Chinese vegetables in the town?
Yeah, probably. At least fresh. They might get dehydrated bitter melon or dehydrated squash. And it would have to come from San Francisco. And so I don't think that they sold, I don't even know if they had a Chinese grocery store when we first came. But this is probably their source of fresh Chinese vegetables. I remember that when beans were growing wild, we had beans every single day, you know. And then after that, when I had to go out and buy them, I wish I had those beans again. But my mother cooked a lot of beans with meat, and maybe more beans than meat. But we were well fed. But we didn't know that we didn't have much money. We only had one truck, and that was sufficient for all 12 of us, but I don't think we ever ate out. And so we never went out to eat and didn't need for all of us to be in the truck at one time.
So would your family usually cook Chinese food?
Yes. But my mother learned from the black people in the neighborhood. She learned to make sweet potato pie, and she would make like half a dozen at a time. I remember the sweet potato pie because I really liked it. But she learned to cook chitlins and hog mao the way they fixed it. And so we were learning to eat black, what they would call, I guess, black soul food, because the black people would teach her how to fix it. So her repertoire of recipes was increased. But we ate largely Chinese food. And my father cooked. My father was a cook by profession, I think. He came and he cooked in that restaurant that my cousin or my uncle owned. But I don't remember, they didn't bake. And so when we got my mother learning to make sweet potato pies, that was really something.
And did your family have a pretty good relationship with the black people in the community?
Yeah, I don't remember playing that much with the black children, but my brothers played basketball and baseball in the yard, and the black people would come in the yard and play with them. Maybe the children, the girls maybe didn't come that much, but we had a good relationship with them. We did not have the problem of the whites really looking down on us like they did maybe in the Mississippi Delta area. After reading the book, I thought, boy, I'm glad my parents moved us to Houston, because we didn't face that much discrimination. There was discrimination. There were areas that the Chinese could not buy a home in. Maybe they couldn't get certain jobs, or they couldn't get promotions because they were Asian, because then they would be over the whites, and the whites maybe wouldn't like that. But I don't really feel that I faced that much discrimination when I was growing up. We did all go to a Chinese church, but the Chinese church had been started by white people. And we met in a, you know, First Baptist Church of Houston. And the workers sometimes were from that church. My sister, my oldest sister, was a Sunday school superintendent, is I think the term they use, of the Chinese church. We didn't necessarily have worship service as much as just having Sunday school classes. She and my sister had attended the Baptist church back in Arkansas. And when they were going to move to Houston, they were given the name of Reverend and Mrs. Westmoreland, who at that time, he was pastor of South Main Baptist Church. And I didn't know how they got the name, but I learned, I'm trying to think when it was, it must have been in the 1980s, my children in Hawaii were going to a Baptist high school, and we had supporters from the mainland who were in the Baptist churches. And this gentleman, when he found out I was from Lake Village, I had been born there, he said, oh, my uncle was the pastor of First Baptist Church, Lake Village, which was where my sisters had attended. But he said, but, you know, he was there many years ago, but his children were still in there, and they evidently gave the name to my sisters to look up and find a church, you know, where the Chinese could go. And Mrs. Westmoreland was the daughter of the pastor of the Lake Village Church.
Okay.
But I find out all of these things through the years, you know. I have, and they come from so many different sources that I would never anticipate learning about it. But there are still some questions I haven't gotten answered.
So when did you realize that, there's discrimination going on, like, in your life?
I think when we started seeing more families move from Arkansas and Mississippi, mm-hmm. and we would hear the stories of them not being able to go to church, go to school with them. I feel like we could have gone to church here with the whites and been accepted, but our parents wanted us to be with Chinese, and so when they organized this Chinese Sunday school, they sent us there. Also, at that time, this was right after World War II started, and all the missionaries in China had to leave. And many stopped off in Hawaii. Now that I live in Hawaii, I know about that. And some, though, came to the southern churches. And there was a Chinese missionary named Pearl Johnson who could speak fluent Cantonese. And she would catch the bus to our grocery store. And there were three Chinese families in that area, and the children in that family would walk over to our house, and she would have like a vacation Bible school, teach us, you know, Bible lessons, and we'd learn songs. I don't remember ever doing any crafts, but I don't even remember how often she came, but it sticks in my mind that she would catch the bus and come to the black neighborhood by herself and teach us. So our lives were really revolved around that church because my sister was so involved and my older brothers, and all of us went to church except my parents because they opened the grocery store and on Sundays and they ran the grocery store. My brothers, of course, by then could drive. So we'd pile into the truck and go, and we sat on soda cases in the back. There was only the two front seats, and we would sit in the back. And we'd complain that so-and-so got to sit in the front more than I did. But we survived.
So were your parents Christian?
They became Christians later. But at that time, they were not. I think they were influenced by the fact that my older sister went to church in Arkansas. The whites wanted to Christianize the Chinese, and so they reached out to the Chinese, and my parents let them go. And then when we came here, our first contact outside of my uncle or cousin at the restaurant was the Westmoreland family, and he told us about the Chinese church.
And how did all the kids become Christian?
In the Baptist church, you have to make a certain decision to become a Christian. It's not like other churches where you're baptized. Mm-hmm. You have to know and understand. We went to Sunday school, so we learned the story of Jesus and how he died for us. And so I think almost all of us were baptized and joined the Baptist Church.
Okay. So what kind of activity did your family do together?
We celebrated all the American holidays. Mm-hmm. I don't ever remember them celebrating New Year's, Chinese New Year's.
Do you know why?
I don't know. I never knew, but we celebrated all the American holidays growing up. You know, Thanksgiving. But we worked. The store was open on Thanksgiving. The store was open on Christmas. And my mother learned to cook turkey. Well, actually, my father roasted the turkey. And our family was big, but we always had people who came over to eat with us. And there was always enough for everybody. And even my brothers, I remember my brother's friends who were white would come over and eat Thanksgiving dinner with us instead of with their families because they thought my father's turkey was the best. And it had a Chinese flavor because he used Chinese seasonings. And my mother's was good, but not as good as my father's.
Did you guys celebrate birthdays?
Yes, but I don't ever remember really having a birthday party, but we celebrated birthdays among ourselves. Remember now, we had enough people coming because of our family was so big.
So did you remember what's the living condition of your neighbors?
Typical black, I guess. There were some really nice homes and then some that were shacks. And the streets were not paved, so when it rained, it was muddy. We delivered. Most of the blacks did not have cars, so when they came to buy their weekly groceries, we delivered it to their house. And when it rained, you know, slippery and everything, you had to drive through all the mud. But there, some of them lived, you know, in nice homes. My friend Faye, whose family had a store not far from us, remembers coming over to play with us, and she would cut through all the black people's yards and had no fear. And we'd go visit her, and we'd cut through all the yards and visit each other, and we would even stop and talk to the black families because we knew them. They were customers, so, and they watched out for us. I don't think they felt threatened by us, and we didn't feel threatened by them. At that time, on the buses, the blacks had to sit in the back, and sometimes it was full, you know, and so they moved up closer to the front, but if a white person got on the bus, the blacks had to get up and give it their seats. And when that happened to us, we hesitated sitting down because these were our customers that they made move. But the bus driver wouldn't move until they moved and we sat down. So we felt that discrimination against them, but not us. We were considered white, I guess. We were not classified as colored. At that time also, there were different drinking fountains. And they were marked colored and white. And I know the first time I saw that, I didn't know where I was supposed to drink. And they told me I was supposed to drink at the white fountain. But
Who told you?
I don't even remember who told me. But I know I wouldn't drink at either one of them because I wasn't sure where I was supposed to get a drink of water.
Can you describe your house that you grew up in?
We had 12 children, and every room was a bedroom because we needed all those rooms. And I always had to sleep with my sister, and I don't know how many of the boys had to be in each room. But we had a kitchen and only one bathroom for all of us. We somehow survived. No one stayed in there too long. You look back and you think, how did you do it? But you adjusted. It wasn't a fancy house, but it was suitable and we didn't complain. I know when I started going to my white friend's house and they had these beautiful living rooms and dens and everything, I thought, I never had that growing up.
How did your parents decorate the house?
I don't think there was any decoration. I don't ever remember any decoration except we did have a Christmas tree.
So were your grocery stores the only one in the black neighborhood around?
No. right across the street was one owned by an Italian family. Oh. And as I said, there were two others owned by Chinese that was walking distance for us when we were little. We probably wouldn't walk there now, but there were other grocery stores, yeah.
So how do you compete with each other? Like, how did you?
I don't know. We just, they had their customers and we had ours. Remember, most of the blacks didn't have cars, so they walked to the nearest one. Oh. So I don't think there was any conflict. I'm trying to think. I heard the story from my friend that before her father bought the grocery store that was kind of near us, he came to see my father and asked if that was okay, because they still had that loyalty to Chinese and didn't want to compete. But my father said it was okay.
So, were your family influenced by World War II?
What was what?
Were your family influenced by what war? The war?
The war?
Yeah.
None of my family served, were old enough, I guess, to serve in World War II. My oldest brother was only 12 when the war broke out. But there were many Chinese from China who came to Dallas, Texas, and I don't remember if they came to Houston for training, but I remember that somehow or another they found out that about our family, and so they were at our house a lot, eating meals with us and even spending the night. And so we had 14 in the house, but I guess we had room for others. my mother probably, you know, worried about her family still in China, because at that time she was the only one, she had come to the United States. She was the only one in the United States, but some of them had gone to Australia and maybe into Hong Kong, but I don't know about that really.
So did she contact her family in Huiping?
She was in contact with them. None of us could write Chinese, and so we would have to, you know, get someone to write for us. And she sent money back to them until her family was so big that she didn't have the money to spend. But my aunt in Australia told me the story about how they always were so excited when they got money from my family, and then when it stopped, they couldn't understand why. And then they realized that she had so many children, so she couldn't send it. But then one time she did send some, and my grandmother was so excited, she hid the money, and then she couldn't remember where she hid it. And whether or not she ever found it, I don't know. But my aunt was telling me that it was such a big, exciting time when, after so many years, my mother was able to send some money. Among my older brother's things, when he passed away, I noticed that he had some letters from the cousins in China, and they were wanted to come over to the United States. But we never did sponsor any of them to come.
Do you remember in World War II, did it affect Asians differently?
Did it affect
Asians differently? Because of the Japanese internment?
You always let people know you were Chinese, because they were fighting with the Americans. But I don't ever remember as a child being called a Jap or you know, being having people think that I was Japanese. But we had Japanese friends who were American, I remember my oldest brother had friends who were farmers, and we were good friends. They were good friends because they were Americans more than Japanese. And we did have, when we were teenagers, we did have a Chinese, well, at that time I guess they would call it an Oriental Basketball League, and there would be a team made up of American-born, or, you know, people who were born in the United States. And then there was a Japanese team, I remember. And then there was a Chinese team made up of Chinese from China. And there were sometimes conflicts between the Chinese-born Chinese and the Japanese. But most of the Japanese were American-born, but they still, those from China still, I guess, had bad feelings about Japanese wherever they came from.
So let's go to like the time when the civil rights movement happened. Do you remember sensing any change in society's acceptance of like Asian or women?
I was not here during the civil rights movement. I lived in Hawaii from 1957 to 59, and then came back for a few years, and then I moved permanently in 61. I was a senior when the University of Texas was opened up to blacks on the undergraduate level. They had been admitted to the graduate level before that. But they didn't come in droves. You know, the blacks, they were not that many, but, and most of them were Baptists, so a few of them came to the Baptist Student Center, and I was active with the Baptist Students Union. But most of us, I don't remember anyone, well, one person was not in favor of them joining us, but the others, most of my friends just accepted them. But see, remember, there weren't that many. Maybe later years there had more. So leaving in 61, I missed all of the riots and the conflicts. The schools were desegregated in those years, and I wasn't here. I was in Hawaii. And in Hawaii, it was a totally different picture because those people, in Hawaii, there was more intermarriage, there was, you know, more... there was diversity, but they lived together more peaceably than on the mainland. So I missed all of the turmoil. Civil rights, I missed.
Okay, so what do you mean by it was more peaceful?
Well, they were all used to going to school together, and they were all used to being in the same professional groups. The Chinese could, you know, had jobs and they could get promoted. There wasn't this feeling that since I'm Chinese, I might not be promoted. This was, Hawaii was already way ahead of the mainland. I'm not saying there wasn't discrimination there. There was, you know, maybe one Chinese mother wanted all her kids to marry Chinese. Well, but it wasn't widespread. You might find, even some didn't want their children to marry Chinese from another group. I had never heard about Hakka and Punti. Had you heard those distinctions? Well, they had them in Hawaii, and the Punti was a little bit higher than Hakka, and so they didn't want their kid to marry someone from the Hakka group.
What was Hakka?
Hakka were kind of nomads in China, and they didn't really have a home. And so I never heard that. But I got to Hawaii, and there was discrimination. Well, not discrimination, but parents not wanting their kids to marry a certain group.
More of a distinction between...
Huh?
More of a distinction between different types of Chinese people?
I don't know that it was that broad, but the Chinese that grew up there knew about it, and I didn't know about it.
Okay. So let's jump to your education experience. So can you tell me about your primary school and middle school experience? So what kind of school like did you go to?
I went to Sherman Elementary, and then I went to Marshall Junior High, and then I went to Jeff Davis, mm-hmm. which I understand has changed its name because it was named after a Confederate general, and so they're getting rid of all those names now in Houston, I understand. I had very close friends among the whites. My family may have been the only Chinese family in the elementary school. Maybe there was one other in high school and junior high. But I was accepted by them. I never had any discrimination, as far as I can remember, in school from the students. And I, you know, met the parents because I would go to my friends' birthday parties and things. And the parents seemed to accept me, but I know there might have been some parents who didn't want their kids to run around with non-whites. But I was fine. Maybe I was so naive I didn't know that anybody discriminated against me. But I don't remember any discrimination.
When was the first time you realized that you were Chinese, or you realize you were different from the others?
I don't know that it was ever a big issue. I know my friends that they never eat Chinese food, and so when they would eat with me, what's this? But that wasn't discrimination. You know, they just had not eaten it before. They always thought we were rich because we came to school in a truck. We had transportation, and we had a grocery store. And during World War II, bacon for some reason was hard to get, and that was our Christmas present to all our teachers. And so, and we didn't even refrigerate it. We would wrap it up in that meat market paper and take it to them. And it stayed out all day. They didn't have a refrigerator for the teachers to put items like that and keep it cold. And all the teachers just loved our Christmas presents because they got bacon.
So did all of your siblings go to the same school?
No. My sister came here and went to Sam Houston and was valedictorian and had scholarships to go to college, but she didn't go because there were so many of us at home. Most of them went to Jeff Davis. My brother David went to Sam Houston. And Marguerite went to Austin, I think. I think we were actually in the Austin district. Well, we were actually in the black school district, but at that time it was segregated. So we did not go to school with the blacks. No one went to school with the blacks except the blacks.
So how, like, who drove you guys to
my
school?
Older brothers. And I didn't drive at that time. And my younger brothers, I had twin brothers, and they drove us. And sometimes we got there late. Quite often we got there late because they couldn't get up in the morning. But when I come to Houston, I meet with friends from seventh grade. There were four of us that were real close. They were all white, and I was the only Chinese. And they tell me now that they had to catch the bus to school, so they would get there, you know, maybe an hour, 45 minutes early. And they would sit there and hope I would get there because they didn't do their math homework. And they were waiting for me to come. And then sometimes I wasn't there because my brothers were late. But one of them said, "Oh, I was so upset when you didn't come to school on time." And I said, "I never knew that. I did not know, I did not realize that they depended on me for their math homework.
Did your parents have like the stereotypical Chinese attitude towards school? Or?
They valued school, and we all went to school. But my sister just above me was the first one to go away to school. I'm not sure which ones went to school, college. Some of them went, you know, and maybe took courses. But they didn't graduate that I can remember. My sister, Mamie, just above me, went to Baylor. And she went 4 years, and she graduated with a degree and became a teacher. And then I came up, and I went to what was called Texas State College for Women in Denton, Texas, and only stayed there 1 year. It's now called Texas Women's University. And then I transferred to the University of Texas at Austin and went 3 years there.
So what were your parents' like hopes for all the children to be when they grow up, and what was your dream job?
There was never any discussion about us, you know, being doctors or lawyers or teachers or whatever. I know that many Chinese friends, their parents wanted them to have a profession, but that was never an issue with us. I don't think they would have cared if we didn't go to college. But I wanted to go. I got a scholarship, and so I went. And I worked in the library and worked for a sociology professor and earned extra money and could help my brothers below me to go to school. So my three brothers below me, I helped two of them through college. And then my sister, younger sister, got a college degree. But there was no pressure on us to be professionals or anything like that.
So how did you get along with other kids and your teachers?
They were fine. The teachers, in those days, most of the Chinese kids did not make any trouble in school. You didn't hear of kids being sent into the office or being held after school. We were good. later on, when they start having problems, everybody says they became too Americanized. But I mean, I'm sure that the Chinese had had kids who were problems. It's just that maybe we were aware that eyes were on us, so we made sure we didn't get in trouble.
Okay. So what did you want to be when you were young?
I always felt like I wanted to help people. I did not want to be a doctor. I did not want to be a lawyer. And so I studied sociology and minored in psychology. And then I applied for a graduate teaching assistantship to the University of Hawaii, and I got it. And I went over there, and it was still sociology, but I studied race relations there. And I didn't finish my master's. I came home, but that was a good experience. That was my first experience being in an area where there were so many Asians. I remember the first time I went to Sears Roebuck and was waited on by a Chinese. It was a funny feeling that I didn't know her. Because here in Houston, I knew most of the Chinese. And none of them, or very few of them, that worked outside the grocery store. And so they wouldn't have gotten a job at Sears. And I remember my roommate, who was white, the only Asian she ever knew was me and my brothers, and she went with me. And she worked in a laboratory at the hospital, and her boss was Chinese, and all the workers were Chinese or Japanese. And so for her, that was really a different experience.
Was there a conflict between your American and Chinese identity when you grew up?
I was probably more American.
Mm-hmm.
And so there wasn't a real conflict, except that I knew that my parents wanted us to marry Chinese. So I didn't date white people. Even though I ran around with them, my social life in Houston was mostly with Chinese. And when I went to college, my social life was mainly with whites. And I never would date any of them, because I always used to say, well, you know, you don't know who you're going to fall in love with, and so if you start dating them, then you're going to have that conflict. But I ended up marrying a Chinese, but I'm thinking my brothers all married Chinese, except one married Japanese. And then my younger sister married a white person. I never used the term white before that much. I always said they were Caucasian.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So you only date Asian people?
Only dated Chinese. I guess I was a coward. I didn't want to face that conflict. Plus, I knew of a family up in Dallas that had a white mother and a Chinese father, and there were some conflicts there. But in Hawaii, it would have been okay.
So was there any conflict between like your parents and your younger sister and brother who married non-Chinese?
No, well, my mother and father were gone when my sister married the white person.
Okay.
And I don't know, I wasn't here when my brother dated the Japanese, but I don't think there was any conflict.
So did you learn to speak Chinese?
I spoke a lot more Chinese when I was little. And in Hawaii, I never speak Chinese. My husband's dialect is different, although he speaks Chinese and his mother was from China. But I didn't understand her dialect. And I never spoke Chinese in Hawaii. So the first time I came back, I realized that I had lost a lot of my Chinese. I could still understand it, but I would speak in half English and half Chinese. And now I've completely lost a lot of it because I don't hear it.
What language did your parents speak at home, kids?
Huh?
What language did they spoke
Chinese mostly.
And would you respond in Chinese or English?
Yeah, at that time I could speak some, yeah. But my father spoke more English, but my mother didn't speak much.
So where did you learn how to speak Chinese?
Only in the home, hearing it at home. But we children now, we never spoke Chinese to each other. Even though the older ones knew more Chinese, we never spoke Chinese that much. We knew, now I know the most Chinese I know is the food. So I can order in Chinese when I go to a restaurant.
So speaking of food, what food do you eat?
Every kind.
Every kind.
Yeah, I cook every kind.
Mm-hmm.
Eat every kind. I cook some Chinese, cook some Japanese, Greek, Italian. See a recipe I like,
mm-hmm.
I try. So there's no distinction between foods. We just like them all. And when I come back to Texas, I come back and get my favorites. I get chicken fried steak. I will get biscuits with the white gravy on it. This is, you know, soul food. I get barbecue, beef.
So when did you learn how to cook? Did you learn from your family?
My father was a good cook, but he passed away when I was a junior in college. But I kind of remembered some of his dishes. My mother, I remember my mother's cooking, so I probably learned more from her because I was in the kitchen chopping. But a lot of it was reading recipes and cooking from the recipes.
So were there any like special recipe from your family that you remember?
Oh my goodness. I remember some of the shortcut recipes that we would use when we'd go to college because, you know, you didn't know how to cook much. But I remember we used canned salmon, this isn't really Chinese. We used canned salmon and we would heat it and then you chop up onions and bacon and peanuts, spread it over, and all the grandchildren learned to cook that. And that they would eat that at college. There was this potato and lop chong, a Chinese sausage dish. My mother learned to cook fried chicken, and her fried chicken was really good. And everybody talked about it. And so she would always make fried chicken when I came home from Hawaii. She would even show me how much salt she used and all that. I never learned to cook as well as she did. Hers was moist. But we talk about that now, and I was telling them that I remember my mother using the fermented bean cake, you know, the squares, and I never cook any dishes with that in Hawaii because no one else did. My husband's family would take the squares and put sugar on it and eat it with their rice, but they never used it, you know, to stir fry vegetables or chicken or anything. So I'm going to go back home and I'm going to do them again so that my grandchildren will get that taste.
So what would you consider a comfort food?
I have comfort food, American foods, and I have comfort Chinese foods. Soups that my mother used to make were so good because we had all the bones from the grocery store. And maybe they didn't want the chicken feet. We had chicken feet to flavor the soups. But I remember my mother making soups a lot, and that was comfort food. And as I mentioned, the American comfort foods were the country fried steak and fried okra and the biscuits and gravy, fried pork chop, you know, with the batter on it. Probably everything that was unhealthy was my comfort food.
Oxtail
soup. My mother used to make it with peanuts. And, oh, we loved it. Black bean with oxtails.
Yeah.
It was a comfort food.
Getting hungry now.
Yes.
You're familiar with those dishes.
So you wrote on your consent form that you started working for Mr. Joe's grocery store when you were 15.
I may have gone there earlier, I can't remember, but it was a Chinese grocery store in a black neighborhood, what I was used to.
Yeah, so who's Mr. Joe?
Hobart Joe was a friend of the family's.
Okay.
When we came, we were probably one of the first Chinese families here, and so we knew, and as more came in, we got to know all of them practically, but these were friends of the family, and that's why I'm thinking it may have been younger, because he would have hired me even younger.
So you mainly work as cashier in
mm-hmm.
the grocery store?
Yeah.
How much did you
earn? We had to remember the prices. They weren't automatically scanned. And so we had to remember the prices of the bread and all the vegetables. The canned goods were marked, I think. I have this feeling that they were marked, but it was harder to be a cashier in those days. You couldn't just run it over the thing and the price came up. And we also had to make our own change. It didn't, when they gave you $20, you didn't press something that tells you how much change you give. We had to learn. So if it was $20.12 and they gave you, like $15.12, you had to remember, you know, if they gave you a quarter, that you just gave them the change for the quarter. I don't know if the kids can do that nowadays. No?
Probably not. So, going to your college education, can you tell me again, like, which university did you go to?
I went to TSCW, mm-hmm. and then I went to University of Texas, and then I went over to the University of Hawaii.
For your master?
Mm-hmm. Okay. But I didn't complete it.
Mm-hmm. And what did you choose? Like, what major?
I was sociology, and when I came back to Houston after being away for almost 2 years, I got a job as a social worker mm-hmm. with a agency called Travelers Aid Society. Back in those days, to qualify for financial assistance, you had to be a resident of the state of Texas. And so Travelers Aid was set up to help those who were non-residents. And so it was temporary. You know, the welfare roles for residents, they could continue on it. But non-residents were aided by our agency, but we didn't help them that long. And then I applied for a job with Red Cross. And that was also as a social worker in a hospital setting. And I went up to Chicago area to a naval hospital up there.
So you moved back to Houston in 59
mm-hmm.
and then left Houston on
in 60. 61. I only worked here. It was probably 60 because mm-hmm. I only worked at Travelers Aid a year.
Okay.
And then went up.
So why did you want to be a social worker?
I've always wanted to be in a field where you help people.
Mm-hmm.
I remember when I came back to Houston, I applied at Travelers Aid and I applied at the Department of Welfare. And when they found out that I had worked in a grocery store with blacks, because a lot of the blacks were on welfare, they took out that application from me immediately because I had experience working with blacks. But I liked the idea of Travelers Aid better. So I went with them.
Wait, so you mean you had an advantage because you worked in a grocery store?
Yeah, that was an advantage because I had worked with blacks and they thought that I could work with the blacks easier in the Department of Welfare than someone who had never had any experience with them.
So how much is the tuition in your college by that time?
Pardon me?
How much is the tuition?
Was it $25 a semester? And I would take 21 hours if I could. I got my money's worth. When they were going to double it the next year, we marched on the Capitol. And my friend was the one who organized it, so I went with him. But it was so low. We were probably number 48 in state tuition back that day. And so they had never raised it, and so we paid $25 a semester. And I think my rent, I rented a studio apartment with a Chinese girl from here, and I think our rent was something like $25.
So that's during your college year?
Yeah.
So did you get any financial aid?
Yes, I did. When I was in high school, I applied for a scholarship with the Tri-Delta sorority, the alumni, and Mrs. Rossiter, who was the head of the scholarship committee, had a friend who, their husbands were in business together, and Mrs. Sterling helped her decide who would get it, and for some reason, Mrs. Sterling decided that she would help me on her own. And so she gave me a scholarship for 4 years. The Tri-Delta scholarship, I think, was for 1 year or only. And so I formed a real friendship with Mrs. Sterling, and she paid for my airfare to Hawaii. And I kept up with her even when I had my children. She sent things for the children, and the children in turn would remember their birthdays and send money back. Mrs. Sterling's husband was the son of Ross Sterling, who was a governor of Texas. And we would send gifts, you know, birthday greetings to him too, and the kids had to make them. I wouldn't let them buy cards. And he was so fascinated with it that he would share it with his buddies. And then he decided to do a scholarship for somebody. But I think he only did it that one time, and that person didn't keep up. But I was so grateful for the help that I kept up with her and, you know, wrote her all the time, and sometimes she would call me. So I kept up with her until she passed away.
So how many of your siblings went to college?
As I said, I think the older ones all went and took courses, maybe went a year or so, but they were all working, and so they would go as they had time, but only Mamie, Johnny, Joy didn't get a scholarship. He went to college. He was one of the twins, so it was Mamie, me, Tommy, and Marguerite. So only four, huh? Five. Oh, Johnny. Okay, five of us had college degrees. Yeah.
Okay. So what extracurricular activity did you do at college?
It was largely with the Baptist Student Union, planning activities, you know, for the Baptist students. I worked in the sociology department and was a member of the sociology honors thing, but we didn't do much. And I was part of the French honor thing, and we would once in a while have cookies and punch stuff. So I helped with that, but you know, I'm not real sure what I did because I was busy working. And I used that money to help my brothers in school. They came in a year after me. And so I was not active in anything on campus, per se.
Okay. So did you still work at the grocery store after you went to college?
Yeah, my brothers took over.
Okay.
Came back from college, and they took over the store. Mm-hmm.
So,
but not now, you know, but they took over the store after they came back. One of them came back from college and had the store until 1980s. Yeah.
Okay. So were there a lot of Chinese students on campus?
At Texas?
Yeah, at Texas.
Yeah, there were. There were a lot who came from San Antonio there. Well, not a whole lot, but maybe I was one of the first few that went from Houston. The people that came after me said, remember Aunt Mary Ann did well? You need to do just as well. So they remind me of this. That's all we heard from our parents.
So were you connected more with the Chinese student there or like Caucasians?
Caucasians. Mm-hmm. Mostly Caucasians. My roommates were Chinese, and we did have some things I did with the Chinese, but mostly Caucasians, because I was active in the church and they didn't go to church. Even though they were Baptists and they went to a Chinese Baptist church in San Antonio or in Houston, but when we got up there, there wasn't a Chinese Baptist church, so they wouldn't go, but I did.
So how did you get along with the Caucasian students?
Fine. No. No discrimination mm-hmm. at all.
Okay. So did they ever like treat you differently because you're Asian?
Not really. Mm-hmm. No, none of them did.
Okay.
They would tease me and say, when are you going to cook a Chinese meal for us? But,
but how do you feel?
I never did.
Okay. So why did you decide to go to the University of Hawaii?
I guess the main reason was I could go there and study and get to know the islands. You know, Hawaii was always the place I wanted to go to. And that was the way to go, because I had a job when I got there. I could go to school.
Mm-hmm.
And Mrs. Sterling gave me the airfare. So, it was set.
So, after you came back from Hawaii, so you started working at the Travelers Aid Society.
Uh-huh.
Can you tell me more about your social work there?
I was the only Chinese on staff.
Mm-hmm.
Most of our clients were Caucasian. I guess the blacks didn't travel that much to new areas. The original Travelers Aid was set up when travelers, you know, suddenly got robbed or something, or they didn't have money. By that time, there were some people that just went to another area and immediately went in to get aid. But I got along well with my co-workers, all of whom were older than me and had children my age. There was one young one. They were willing to give me a scholarship to go back to college and get a degree in social work. But by then I had applied for a job with Red Cross and was gonna go to another area. So I liked to travel, but I didn't have the funds to travel, and so I would have to get jobs in order to go.
Okay. So I saw that you wrote on your form that is located in Greyhound Bus Station in Houston, the Traveler Aid Society.
Yeah.
So what's the working condition there?
We had a big room, and it was glass, and so everybody could see us. So I never had any fear, because it was always, we had to work there one night a week. And I never had any fear, because the agents selling tickets could see us. But we were in a place where people who rode the bus, if they needed help, came in. And it wasn't, you know, some days you might have one person, some days you might have three, some days you might have nobody. But you were the only one there.
Do you remember any people that stood out, any cases that you worked on?
There were some people that you got to know better. There was one family whose daughter, I remember, had a breathing disease, and they got here and were scared. And so we helped them to settle in until the husband found work. But got close to them, but I can't even remember their names.
So how much did you earn by that time?
I can't remember how much I made then. It was better than working in the grocery store.
What about like in Hawaii?
Hawaii now, I was only supposed to work part-time, mm-hmm. and I got my tuition paid, mm-hmm. and so the salary was good. When I decided to not go for the second year, I went to work for a state agency called the Commission on Subversive Activities, which was formed to investigate the ones that they thought were communist. I worked as a clerk typist there. And I think I made something like $275 a month. But I had applied at a bank, and the bank was only willing to pay me $10 more than I made at the university, and it was for 40-hour week. So then I knew that my pay was pretty good at the university.
That's nice. So were you supporting your family still?
No. Well, yeah. I think Johnny and Tommy were both still in school. So I still paid for their tuition, which was still $25 because they hadn't doubled it yet. and I paid for their rent. They didn't get a lot of money to spend on running around. Mm-hmm.
So, why did you leave Hawaii for Houston?
My roommate and I had plans to go home for a little while and apply mm-hmm. for jobs in Japan or Hong Kong. Now, she wasn't Chinese, but she was game to go with me. So that's why we came back, to work a little while and earn enough to go and meanwhile apply for jobs to go overseas. And we never got there. She went back to Austin and worked, and that's when I started doing the Red Cross and Traveler's Aid. And then I married in 61, so I went back to Hawaii. Okay. What was your question?
Have you ever visited China?
Yeah. I've gone to China and Japan, Malaysia, Singapore, Bangkok. I've done Europe. I didn't visit all of the countries in Europe. I've gone to Australia. So I've traveled more than my siblings, but I guess from way back I wanted to travel, which is why my college education and my work has been in different areas of the United States.
So have you ever met any work discrimination?
No. I'm trying to think of any incidents. No. In fact, they always felt that Chinese worked hard. Chinese were good workers. Have you heard that?
Yeah.
And even today you hear that. Mm-hmm. I have a daughter-in-law from Singapore. She works for Wells Fargo, not in sales or anything, but in doing research. And almost all her colleagues are Chinese. Her superior tends to hire Chinese because he says they're good workers.
So after you moved from Houston to Chicago, right? And then you moved to Hawaii after you got married.
Yeah.
So does your family still have like family reunion because you are like in different places?
I come back to visit. My sisters don't come back as often as I do. They live on the West Coast. They will come back for funerals, I hate to say. I don't know if they ever came back for class reunions, but I did. This time I came back for a class reunion. And last year, I can't remember why I came, but I usually don't come 2 years in a row. But now I only have a brother and his wife and a niece and a nephew that live in Houston. and three sister-in-laws. Three sister-in-laws who have lost their husbands, my brothers. So I come back to visit.
Did you ever confront, like, the people who paid you?
No, it really didn't matter. Uh-huh. Nickel. But you worked on commission, and so we had a lot of sales during Christmas time. And then I continued to work at Sears. Mm-hmm. You know, they asked me to come back, and so I would work a couple of nights a week.
So was he a student? Was he a student as well?
At that time?
Yeah.
I was still in graduate school.
Yeah. I mean, your husband.
Oh, no, my husband was out of school and working. Well, maybe he had gone to school in California, no, in Oregon, and then he was in school in Chicago and working at the same time.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So how did you start dating?
He just asked me out. I don't remember. And I'm trying to think. He liked to play tennis, but I didn't play tennis. But I would go to the tennis courts and sit there and watch.
So, okay. What drew you to him?
He was Chinese. I guess he was college educated and he had traveled. So he had some sense of living in other places. And we just, you know, hit it off because we had some of the same interests.
And, like, when and how did you decide to get married and move together?
I went back to being a wedding.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, we'd been writing, and so we saw each other again. I'd been away, I guess, a year and a half by then. And then we decided that we were the right ones for each other. So we got married in October of 61. And I've lived in Hawaii since.
Did you discuss it with your parents or your family? Did you discuss it with your parents when you decided to get married?
Not really. My father was already gone. It was only my mother. But I knew she'd be happy. It was Chinese.
Did they attend your wedding in Hawaii?
I had my wedding in Texas.
Oh. And
I got married in Houston.
Okay. So then you moved to Hawaii.
Mm-hmm.
So is that because your husband is from Hawaii?
Well, he had already started working in Hawaii.
Oh, okay.
And so I could leave. I quit working for Red Cross and came home, and then I didn't have a job. So when I got to Hawaii, I worked there for the Department of Social Services, which was the welfare department, and worked until I had my children. And then after they were in school, then I did substitute teaching. I didn't go back to full-time work, although sometimes I would take a long-term, 1 or 2 months job, substitute teaching. But I didn't work full-time, but I did volunteer work there.
So how many kids do you have?
Four children, 3 girls and 1 boy.
When were they born?
One was born in 64, mm-hmm. 65, 68, and 71. Mm-hmm. And 3 of them live on the mainland now, and only one returned to Hawaii.
Oh, okay.
But they all went to college on the mainland, so they chose to stay there. They got jobs,
mm-hmm.
and so they stayed on the mainland.
So what does your husband do?
He worked for Sears and was a assistant manager,
mm-hmm.
of the furniture department. And then Allstate came to Hawaii, and that was part of Sears at that time, Allstate Insurance. And I don't know if he applied or if they came to him. I never really knew about that. He was the first Asian hired by Allstate Insurance in the United States. And of course now they have a lot of Chinese and Japanese, different nationalities, but he was the first Chinese to work for Allstate Insurance. So he worked for them for 40 years. But he never wanted to become a manager or anything. He stayed as a salesman.
So did you have any like expectation when your kids are growing up?
My expectations were probably what most parents wanted mm-hmm. them to be happy, hardworking. I was pretty strict. They tell me I was pretty strict. And we did a lot of things together as a family, took vacations. I was very active in their school, and so was on their, on school campus a lot. They went to church and made friends at church and at school. We expected college education, and they all wanted to go, and they all chose to go on the mainland. Mm-hmm. We live on the hill above the University of Hawaii on one side and a Catholic university, but they wanted to go away. And we really wanted them to go away because, you know, you grow when you have to leave home and worry about your meals and your laundry and how to get places. We let them come home at Christmas and for the summer. But they worked when they came home, usually even at Christmas and the summer, because the people they worked for wanted them to work. They were good workers. In fact, I have had contact with the people that three of them worked for, and they always say, your kids were the best workers we had. So that made me feel good. They had learned how to work for their pay and even do a little extra. And so they became good friends with their bosses.
So do you expect your children to marry like Chinese?
It didn't bother me because by then there was more intermarriage, and I remember I lived in Hawaii now mm-hmm. for 50-something years. And so one of my oldest daughter married a Japanese. The second one isn't married. She's a career girl. The third one married a Caucasian. And the last one married a Chinese.
So is there any family tradition you ever tried to establish?
Well, when I got to Hawaii, I learned more about Chinese traditions because Hawaii, even though there are so many different groups there, each one still adheres to their traditions. The Japanese still do things, you know, that they did in the old country, the Chinese still do. So I learned a lot about Chinese traditions that I had never learned before. My mother didn't do any Chinese traditions. We never served tea to her. And when I got to Hawaii, the whole family was together and I was expected to serve tea to them. And they had a Mandarin jacket for me to wear. I mean, they were pretty traditional. And even now, some of my husband's brothers, even though there's lots of intermarriage in the family, expects the grandchildren to serve them tea and do things like that. I don't expect that of my kids. They're too Americanized, and maybe I'm too Americanized. But they know about them. I sent my two oldest to Chinese school, and they can read and write. They can't carry on a conversation. The last two didn't go to Chinese school. But my son took up Japanese, so he can speak Japanese, not Chinese. And he studied in Japan for a while. All my children went away to the mainland, so they had to learn being away from home, learn skills for taking care of themselves.
So do you have any like Chinese traditional culture that you want to pass on to your kids?
It really doesn't necessarily have to be Chinese. I want them to continue to go to church. I want them to continue to reach out to people and be helpful. I want them to study, go to college, but that's not necessarily Chinese. Mm-hmm.
I just have one more question. Did you and your siblings have Chinese names?
Yes. And my own children have Chinese names. And they also, the ones that are Japanese, have a Japanese name. My daughter, who's married to the Caucasian guy, gave her kids a Chinese name and a Hawaiian name. It was just their choice. And the names are on the birth certificate. Our family, the names were not on the birth certificate. We know our parents gave us the names. We know what they were. But in Hawaii, they put them on the birth certificate. So when you graduate, they will say Sarah, Chiemi, Lila, and Young, or Nakamoto, right? And so they have this long name, and everybody has it pretty much.
Yeah. So what's your Chinese name?
Mei Oi. Beautiful love. And at one time I knew how to write it, and I've forgotten how to write it. But my grandchildren now are taking Japanese and Mandarin.
So who gave the Chinese name to your children?
I guess my mother. I never did find out. Now, my children, I have a sister-in-law from China, and she gave my children their Chinese name.
Do you have anything to add?
No, not really. I didn't feel that I was knew enough about what happened in Houston to be a worthy candidate for interview because I've been away for so long. And I didn't know anything about Arkansas and Mississippi.
But it doesn't have to be specifically.
Yeah, it's about you.
So. About me. No, I don't have anything to add.
Okay.
Okay. So that ends the interview. Okay.
Okay.
Thank you so much.